All right. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. It is now 3 minutes after 7 o'clock. We're here at the City Hall Forum for our regularly scheduled meeting of the Beloit City Council, 100 State Street, Beloit, Wisconsin. We've called to order, so roll call.
We have 6 councilors present, with Councilor Hendricks absent.
All right, thank you. Item 2 is Pledge of Allegiance. Will you all please stand?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Item 3, special orders of the day and announcements. Item 3A.
Is a proclamation declaring April 29th, 2016 as Arbor Day.
Madam Vice President.
Thank you. Whereas in 1872, J. Sterling Morton proposed to the Nebraska Board of Agriculture that a special day be set aside for the planting of trees. And whereas this holiday, called Arbor Day, was first observed with the planting of trees in Nebraska. And whereas Arbor Day is now observed throughout the nation and the world. And whereas trees can reduce the erosion of our precious topsoil by wind and water, cut heating and cooling costs, moderate the temperature, clean the air, produce oxygen, and provide habitat for wildlife. And whereas trees are a renewable resource giving us paper, wood for our homes, fuel for our fires, and countless other wood products. And whereas trees in our city increase property values, enhance the economic vitality of business areas, and beautify our community. And whereas Beloit has been recognized as a Tree City USA by the National Arbor Day Foundation and desires to continue its tree planting ways. Now, therefore, the City Council President of the Beloit City Council does hereby declare April 29th, 2016 as Arbor Day in the City of Beloit and urge all citizens to support efforts to protect our trees and woodlands and to support our city's urban forestry program. And be it further proclaimed that all Beloit citizens are encouraged to plant trees to brighten the community and promote the well-being of present and future generations. Dated this 18th day of April, 2016, Charles M. Haynes, President. And I believe Mr. Ferger is here. Words that you want to say about Arbor Day?
Sure. I'm Mike Ferger. I'm your Forestry Operations Supervisor. Tonight I brought the crew with me. We have our tree crew, city tree crew. Jay Schultz, wave your hand there, Jay. Max Small, Derek Lutie, Tom Hulbert, and the glue that keeps us together is Ann Hill on the end there. Thank you very much. I'd like to invite you to our Arbor Day extravaganza at Frozen Intermediate School on the 29th at 10 a.m. I hope you all will attend.
Thank you. Item 3B.
Is a proclamation declaring April 28th, 2016 as Stand Against Racism Day. An official proclamation of the City of Beloit. Whereas racism and discrimination hurt everyone and have a profound effect on children, adults, communities, and institutions. And whereas racism can take many different forms, including discrimination, personal attacks, violence, written or verbal threats or insults, damage to property, graffiti, or inequity of treatment to individuals of race, color, creed, and ethnicity by institutions. And whereas the City of Beloit recognizes that all people should be treated with dignity, respect, and justice. And whereas Stand Against Racism Day is a nationally recognized initiative with a purpose to encourage communities to raise awareness that racism still exists while offering to be a part of the solution to end racism and other forms of discrimination. And whereas racism acts of hate, violence, and disparities in our institutions based on race, religion, ethnic heritage, gender, gender orientation, or disability not only affect the victim, but affect our entire community and nation. And whereas the City of Beloit supports the mission of YWCA Rock County to eliminate racism in our nation, state, and community. Now, therefore, the City Council President of the Beloit City Council does hereby declare Thursday, April 28th, 2016, as Stand Against Racism Day in the City of Beloit, and calls upon all Beloit citizens to support celebrating diversity and promoting racial justice in the Beloit community, dated this 18th day of April, 2016, Charles M. Haynes, President. I know we have Executive Director Angela Moore here with the YWCA. And
thank you. Uh-huh. Thank you so much, Sheila. Thank you. Thank you for this this resolution. We're very proud of our mission, which is eliminating racism and empowering women. In this vein, we'd like to bring community awareness to the issue of racism and asking the community to join us on April 28th for our Stand Against Racism Day. And I have flyers, a handout. We will be assemble at the First National Bank Plaza at noon, and it will end at 12:30. But you can still have your lunch, et cetera. But we're going to just come out together as a community and have a discussion. We have invited the Beloit Memorial High School girls soccer team to join us to show our support for them as a community. We want to give them Stand Against Racism pins and just demonstrate our support for them. Others will be there, and we will even ask that this proclamation be read also on that day. So please come out, and thank you for your efforts to eliminate racism in our city. Thank you.
Thank you.
At this time, we have some acknowledgments of outgoing city councilors.
Yes, we have two of my fellow councilors are rolling off the council, and we'd like to go ahead and present some tokens of our esteem to them. Ms. Chuck Kincaid and Anna Kelly, and we'd like to go ahead and give you the gift of a plaque, if you'd please join me. Yes. Terrible shock.
Yeah, I like it.
Right. Well, Anna, here is yours. This is a little token of our esteem for the years that you've put in service. I have to say that I'm proud to call you my friend. I'm also proud that you've joined us in working through the city's problems together. And your efforts are herein contained in all the committees. And we're going to see each other often as friends, but I can tell you that I'll miss this bit of camaraderie. And I appreciate that very much.
Well, thank you.
And Chuck, here's yours. This also, it's heavy. It's nice. It's very attractive. And it shows your years of service and the commissions that you've been on. And I have to say that the time that we've spent talking has been been amazingly informative. I can't. Your counsel and your thoughts and your efforts have enriched my time on the council and my understanding of the community, and I can't say it enough how much I appreciate that.
Thank you.
All right, and for each of you, we have some acknowledgments. First, for Anna, we have a gift for you. If you can open that. Yes.
Is this something? Yep. Oh, very nice.
Wow. This. Oh,
It's a shirt that actually uses some lines from a handbill, an antique handbill that was used to encourage people to come to Beloit for all the many beauties of Beloit and the wonderful aspects of Beloit. And we just really want to appreciate Anna for coming to this community and just jumping right in her service to it. You and Rick have been wonderful benefits to our community, and we really appreciate that. So that's a gift for you.
Thank you so much.
Chuck Kincaid.
Where's my t-shirt?
You have a different gift. You can open it.
You don't get to make music and money like me.
And this is actually a reprint of that handbill for Chuck Kincaid to hang in his home for him and Sandy to have. And then for our President Haynes, we have two things. One is presented to you, Charles M. Haynes. We have a resolution, and then also an appreciation of your years of service. A swamp white oak tree will be planted in Zonta Memorial Park.
Well, thank you.
And then we have one other thing.
I don't know, exactly.
That's for you to open. It's heavy.
All right, let's set it down.
Sorry.
That's okay.
Yes, you can help them.
Okay, so this is
A soapstone for Charles to put in his garden, and it says Charles Haynes, Beloit City Councilor, 2008 through 2016. So we want to thank each of you for your service. It's been an honor and a privilege to serve with each of you, and all of the city councilors appreciate you.
Thank you. There you go. So, that little
back
bit
to business at 4A.
Exactly. All right, exactly. So, 4A.
Is a resolution authorizing a conditional use permit to allow a fitness studio in an R1B single-family residential district for the property located at 103 8th Street.
All right, I'd like to, staff report first.
Annabelle Sagato is seeking permission to hold fitness classes in the garage attached to the commercial building. Which is actually on Sherland Avenue. Her intent is to hold 1-hour-long exercise class for 1 hour daily, with the possibility of additional classes being added. The space will not function as a traditional gym or fitness center, but instead the indoor area will be used to hold classes like Zumba that don't need traditional gym equipment. There's a clothing store that currently occupies part of the commercial building on this property and is a legal non-conforming use. The zoning code states that a legal non-conforming use may be altered in accordance with the conditional use procedures if the new use will have a lesser negative impact. We do think this will not have a negative impact on what's already there. The fitness studio is classified as retail sales and service. Entertainment oriented use and requires one parking spot per 150 square feet. The site currently has enough parking spaces for this use. Planning Commission reviewed this at their last meeting on April 6th and voted unanimously 4-0 to recommend approval, subject to the conditions which are listed in the resolution. Which are that this conditional use permit authorizes the operation of a fitness studio in the attached garage and the commercial building located at 103 A Street. It's addressed as 549 Sherland on that side of the building. The applicant must obtain an architectural review certificate for any proposed signage. Classes may only be held between the hours of 6 a.m. and 10 p.m. The fitness studio must adhere to the noise regulations in accordance with Section 15.12 of the Municipal Code. Customers must park in the designated parking lot on the property. If city staff receives frequent complaints about parking or excessive noise from neighbors or observes any illegal parking or unreasonable loud activity at the property, this conditional use permit shall be null and void and the site shall be restored to its prior condition. This restoration order shall only be issued after the Planning Commission has reviewed the complaints and the applicant has been afforded the opportunity to explain and or cure the circumstances giving rise to the issues. A building official must perform an inspection to ensure the space is adequately lit and ventilated before the use is established. And then our standard condition about major changes coming back through this public process and minor changes being approved administratively. The neighborhood was notified and no one came out of Planning Commission or no one called us.
Okay. All right, thank you. I'd like to open the public hearing on item 4A. Anyone wishing to come forward and speak on item 4A, please approach the podium and state your name and address. Second call for persons to come forward and speak on item 4A. Third and final call for persons to come forward and speak on item 4A. Hearing none, I'll close the public hearing on item 4A. And do I have a motion to approve?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Moved by Lupke, second by Kincaid. Do we have any questions or comments on this? Hearing none, we'll call the matter. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Item passes by a vote of 6-0. So. Item 5 is citizens' participation. We've reached the point in the meeting for members of the public to speak to the council about issues that are coming before us or may come before us in the future. The council will not act on any requests this evening unless an item you are also speaking about is also on our agenda, but we may act on requests at a future meeting or may refer a speaker to staff for assistance. We ask that you hold your comments to 3 minutes or less and avoid making personal attacks. I have two people who have said that they wish to come forward and speak under citizens' participation. I'll call first Stephen Phillips. Please approach the podium and state your name and address.
My name is Stephen Phillips. I live at 2006 North Street. And I'm here for, I purchased a property on 2018 Portland Avenue under a quit claim deed. And it has garbage, and the house has got garbage all in it. And I'm asking if I can have your support on, I want to fix the house up and clean the garbage up. And I've been trying to talk to people, but I ain't really getting no answers. And I don't want to go put the house in my name if you guys are going to tear it down and I'll be charged with it. So I really don't know what to do because nobody will talk to me about it. So I'm coming here to talk to you guys about it. And I have over 200 signatures of the neighbors in a 3-block radius that I walk to that support me. And some of them even said they'd help me clean the property up. So I'm just asking for you guys' support on it. I have a dumpster waiting to be dropped at the house on Wednesday morning. It's the quickest I could get one. And I'd have all the garbage out of there by the end of the week. And I just need some time to work on the house. And I'll work with the city. And I'd come here every Monday until the house was up to your guys' code.
Okay. All right, sir. If you do have those signatures, feel free to go ahead and give those to the city manager, and we'll have a chance to discuss this with you at another time.
Okay.
And Madam City Manager.
As a matter of practice, we don't typically respond to public comment, particularly when there are no items on the agenda. However, staff has spoken with Mr. Phillips, and I think it needs to be clear that the bids were already issued for the demolition of this property. We've been in a progressive process with this particular property for at least the last year. And so at this point in the process, I do not believe that we have an opportunity to avoid moving forward. While I very much appreciate the signatures that have been received here, we have also received a number of phone calls from neighbors who have asked why has it taken so long to have this particular property remedied. That is, you know, no fault of yours. You are not the previous owner. But we have every reason to believe that this particular property cannot be salvaged and must be demolished. So as a point of reference, again, this is not an item under the agenda this evening.
Right. Thank you. Right. Thank you, sir. I refer you to staff for further action. All right. Second item is Carol Jacobson.
I have a handout for the council people. And good evening. And I would like folks at home to see the property that I'm going to be discussing with the council. Hope you saw it. It's a condemned house with a landfill of trash in front. Property at 2018 Portland has looked like this for nearly 2 years. Many of the neighbors are here tonight to support the proposals I would like to make. Oh, I didn't give my name and address.
It's okay, ma'am. That's all right.
Brief history of the property. Neighbors have called repeatedly to get this taken care of, and this is an habitual nuisance property along with 904 Williams Street. We've done all we thought we could do. It hasn't seemed to be enough until recently. This property, according to Vicki Brown, Rock County Treasurer, is in foreclosure for delinquent taxes. She will foreclose on it in September with taxes due of $5,679.45. I was told by a staff member of the City of Beloit the property is to be raised by month's end by CCI at a cost of $4,786. You add those together, it's $10,465.45. All of these costs will be absorbed by the City and County of Rock taxpayers. In addition, this property has received citations amounting to approximately $10,000 in fines. These sorts of properties with landfills should not be tolerated anywhere in the city. If this property was more visible to visitors to the city, it would have been removed quickly. How many of you would live next door to or across the street from a property like this? This devalues all properties in the neighborhood. I believe the council sets the codes, fines, and time frame for compliance. It is our request that properties such as this, with trash and garbage, possibly hazardous, be given a very limited time frame for cleanup. This is an eyesore. It erodes the health and welfare of our neighborhood. So if it's not addressed by the homeowner, the city will quickly, not years, clean it up at homeowner's expense. We would appreciate being informed as to the changes made and remedies that are implemented. Friends and neighbors of mine from around the city are watching this as well. They live in many different neighborhoods. There was a petition circulating. You talked to Stephen, or he talked to you before me, over the weekend, and I signed it. Came to my door, and I signed it. Even though I've said I had this all prepared by then. Because I felt bad, because I felt like he was being taken advantage of. And I have found out other information over the weekend that kind of dispels some of what I was led to believe. So I have crossed my name off of the petition. Should not be on there anymore. And that's all I have.
Well, thank you, ma'am. And just to assure you that no one could want what you want more than we do. If there's remedy to be had, we will certainly pursue it. Thank you.
But could we it's got to be sooner.
If we could ask you to follow up with staff, because they'll explain. We have, unfortunately, some pretty strict legal guidelines that we have to follow before we can condemn a property that takes a very long time we have to follow.
I'm actually not talking about the condemnation of the property as much as I'm talking about the trash that more has come since I took that picture.
Well, yes, ma'am, and we understand, we're going to get a chance to talk.
I'm talking about the trash removal.
At this point, we'll refer you to staff, and we'll have these discussions, because these are the kinds of discussions we need to have. So we want you to understand, and we want to understand your problems.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, yes, go ahead.
Just very quickly, so everyone's aware, 2018 Portland Avenue, because those bids were already opened and those were accepted, not only will the removal of the home occur, but all of the garbage, everything at the home will be removed, and it's within the next 30 days, less than 30 days. So all of that will be taken care of at one time. And again, as the counselor was indicating, we appreciate your frustration. There are a number of rules that we have to follow. We have to provide notice. We have to provide opportunities to cure. And so that does take time. But we hear your concern and are happy to discuss it with you further.
All right, thank you. Oh, yes, yes, ma'am. That's something we well understand. So thank you. All right. Do we have any other persons wishing to come forward and speak under citizens' participation? Second call for persons to come forward and speak under citizens' participation. Third and final call for persons to come forward and speak under citizens' participation. Hearing none, I'll close citizens' participation. We'll move on to the consent agenda, item 6. All items that listed in the consent agenda are considered routine and will be enacted by one motion. There'll be no separate discussion of these items unless the council member so requests, in which event the item will be removed from the general order of business and considered at this point of the agenda. Councilor DeForest, did you have something that you wanted to remove?
Yes, I'd like to request that item 6B, as in boy, be removed, please.
All right. Do we have any other councilors wishing to remove an item from the consent agenda? Hearing none, the consent agenda consists of item 6A and 6C through 6J. Do we have a motion to approve the consent agenda?
Moved
by Kelly, second by Sloniker. All in favor of approval of the consent agenda as amended, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Item passes by a vote of 6-0. And item 6B.
Is an application for a Class B beer and a Class C wine license for the Flying Pig Treat Shops located at 431 East Grand Avenue. Deborah Nelson, agent.
All right. To get this on the table, do we have a motion to approve?
Motion to approve.
Moved by Lubke.
Second.
Second by Kelly.
Okay.
Sorry, I had to pick. What question do you have for us on this, Councilor DeForest?
Thank you. I'm hoping the business owner is here to address my question. This is currently a treat shop where there's candy and slushies, and it's a popular place for kids to go, and I'm just trying to understand why we would want to have a liquor license here. I think it sends a not so great message to the kids that like to hang out there.
We're serving, my name's Lisa Dodd, I'm the owner, I live in Rockton. Do you need my address, or?
Yes, please.
It's 125 Colbrook Place, Rockton.
Okay.
Thank you for being here.
Sure. We've added lunch, and so it's mainly just gonna be served with, if someone's having lunch, with their lunch.
Okay, so. And you feel in your business model that you won't be able to be successful if you're serving lunch without serving alcohol?
I don't know. I just thought it would add something to it. We've had a lot of customers ask us about that, even when we lived when we were located across the street.
You had customers asking you about liquor when you were just selling treats?
When they found out that we were going to be having lunch and buying the building across the street.
Okay. All right, thank you.
I don't plan on it being like a bar atmosphere or anything like that.
Okay. Thank you for answering my question.
Okay, thanks. All right, any other questions or comments?
My thing.
Okay, Councilor Lupke?
I received two emails earlier today, and also questioning, and I answered them both, and what I basically said was that the prior owner had a full license in there, and you only want a wine and beer one, which is a lot less than the prior owner. I went in there a lot when it was called Fromage. They had some wonderful bakery items and treats, and it was a very popular place, packed on Saturday mornings and during Bith, etc. And we had lots of kids in there. Granted, there are you do sell a lot of treats. But by expanding and going to sandwiches and other offerings, that would probably enhance your bottom line. And so I personally have no problem with the wine and beer if done appropriately. So I explained that in my email back to these people that had questioned this. I just wish you a lot of good fortune there.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Do we have any other questions or comments from councilors? Hearing none, I'll call the matter. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Nay.
Okay, that is a vote of 4-2 with Councilors Sloniker and DeForest in the negative. All right. Item 7 is ordinances. Item 7A.
Item 7A is an ordinance to repeal and recreate Section 8-900 and 8-1000 of the Zoning Ordinance, Chapter 19 of the Code of General Ordinances, relating to construction site erosion control and post-construction stormwater management. This is second reading.
Madam Director.
The DNR has set an implementation of May 1st, 2006 for the updated ordinances. The purpose of the 8-900 is to prevent and control water pollution and soil erosion by limiting the amount of sediment and other pollutants carried by runoff. It sets an explicit limit on the amount of sediment that can be discharged from construction sites larger than an acre. Requires an erosion control plan, and then we enforce it during inspections. The 8-1000 is the post-construction stormwater management. It only applies after construction is complete. Developers are required to submit a written stormwater management plan and maintenance agreement, and stormwater infrastructure must remove 80% of suspended solids on new construction and 40% of solids on redevelopment construction. You held your public hearing and first reading at your last meeting. Plan Commission recommended approval, and it's on your agenda for action tonight.
Thank you. Thank you. All right, this is a second reading. Do we have a motion to approve?
So moved.
Moved by DeForest.
Second.
Second by Lupke. Do we have any other questions or comments from councilors? Hearing none, I'll call the matter. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Item passes by a vote of 6-0. Item 7B.
Is an ordinance to amend Section 6.3.4 sub D of the Zoning Ordinance, Chapter 19 of the Code of General Ordinances of the City of Beloit, relating to detached accessory buildings for garbage and recycling container storage. This is second reading.
Madam Director.
You may recall from the last meeting, our zoning ordinance currently only allows two detached accessory structures. This ordinance would allow a third structure, which would just be used for the new carts that are being done as part of the automated trash system. And it's on your agenda for action.
All right, thank you. Do we have a motion to approve for the second reading?
Motion to approve.
Moved by Lupke.
Second.
Second by Kelly. Do we have any other questions or comments? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Item passes by a vote of 6-0. Item 7C.
Is an ordinance to amend various sections of the Code of General Ordinances for the City of Beloit pertaining to city boards, committees, and commissions. This is second reading.
Madam City Manager.
Okay. This is a second reading for proposed changes to the boards, committees, and commissions ordinance. There were two public meetings that were held, one of which every current member of every board, committee, and commission was invited to attend. We had a good turnout at the public library. And the primary objective prior to having this conversation was really to enhance the representation on these boards, committees, and commissions to include as many individuals from the public as possible. We had experienced in March and April 27 vacancies for those 15 various committees. And so with only six applications at that point in time that were coming forward. I think some of the public discussion has helped receive more applications, so that has been a positive result thus far. But overall, the amendments to the ordinance include the following. The Ethics Board is created in a manner that ensures that there will be an adequate quorum should one be required. This particular board typically only meets once a year unless there is an item of concern that is raised for their consideration. The proposed amendment allows the chair of the Community Development Authority, the Municipal Library Board, the Park Recreation Conservation Advisory Commission, and the Plan Commission, and Police and Fire Commission, those five, to serve as standing members of the Ethics Board. That would be in conjunction with two at-large citizen appointees. The next item addresses meeting times for some of the committees and commissions from 6:30 to 8 p.m., and that is to allow additional opportunities for individuals in the public to provide comment or to be present if desired. There's nothing that would prohibit the remaining committees and commissions from meeting during that time period for any that it is not specifically defined. It is also our belief that each of those boards, committees, and commissions would establish their regular meeting schedule on an annual basis. Those would then be posted on our website and published accordingly. There is one item to allow sitting council members who are on different boards, committees, and commissions to vote when that is required for a quorum, and when it is required for a quorum only. That has occurred when there was business to be attended to and a quorum was lacking at some of the commissions, such as Parks and Recreation Advisory Commission. There is an item that includes interviews for critical appointments to boards, committees, and commissions that have a great deal of autonomy and authority, such as the library, the Police and Fire Commission, etc. While those have always been permitted and certainly aren't prohibited by any of our current ordinances, this explicitly requests that those interviews be conducted. And then there are some minor changes to cleanup and modernization of the ordinances. One item that I neglected to point out previously is that the language that references removal for cause is defined actually in the state statute. I apologize, I referenced it as ordinance, and it's in the state statute actually, that defines cause as inefficiency, neglect of duty, official misconduct, or malfeasance. Our prior, or our existing, if you will, ordinance allows for removal for cause by other sitting members of the same committee. The amended language allows any resident to present a motion for cause that would then have to be investigated. So that's the intention there. And the purpose was to broaden it from other sitting committee members who may or may not know that a potential conflict of interest that might rise to cause exists.
All right. All right. Do we have... I know that we're going to be dealing with some discussions here. I'll rather than open it up with a motion, I think we'll go ahead and just actually start the discussion. Councillor DeForest, I think that you were.
I'm going to need a motion to get it on the
floor. Okay. All right. Okay. So let's go ahead and do that anyway.
I'll make the motion.
Moved by Lupke, second by Kincaid. All right, Councillor DeForest.
Thank you. I have quite a few points. One is, I guess I'll just start one at a time, that I would like to make an amendment that included in the requirement that committees, there are certain committees that are outlined that are required to meet between 6:30 and 8 p.m. to make sure that they are as accessible to residents as possible. And I would like to see that traffic review and the Equal Opportunities Commissions be included in that requirement. And my rationale for that is that given the nature of the Equal Opportunities Commission committee, I think it's very important that the public has access to that committee, that they're able to address concerns to that committee and facilitate
rotating that 6:30 to 8 time would make it easier for most individuals who would tend to work during normal business hours. Also, I can't tell you how many times I've had residents that have specifically shared with me their frustration that they wanted to attend traffic review to address that committee and could not because it met at 1:30. That has not just happened a handful of times. I'd say probably in the last 8 years, at least a dozen times. And given that very real anecdotal request, I think that we should honor the fact that traffic review should also be included as one of the committees that's required to meet between 6:30 and 8 p.m. So I'd like to request that amendment be made to this ordinance, and I don't know if I should start there or go through my list.
All right, if I can have a second. Do you wish to? Well, if why don't you go ahead and finish, and then you can decide how you want to couch your amendment.
The other thing that I would like to see explicitly included in this ordinance is just at the beginning of the ordinance that there is a very explicit stipulation that a regular set meeting day and time is set at the beginning of the year and followed for the course of the year. I don't know if that's clearly communicated in this ordinance, and that is the assumption, but I just want to make sure that while we don't want to define the particular days and times in the ordinance per se, we do want to make sure that our committees, commissions, and boards know that the expectation is that they do set a regular schedule each year so the public knows what it is and knows when they can attend those meetings. So that would be another amendment I'd like to see included as that explicit direction to those commissions, committees, and boards. I also have two comments I'd like to make. One is I really feel it is imperative to allow counselors to be able to vote when there's a quorum. I have seen this in action over the last 8 years where I've served on a committee, we did not have a quorum, and we have residents who have come to that meeting with their concerns, have taken their time to come to address business that they had, and were not able to do so because we did not have a quorum. And so I think it's critical, and this has not just happened a couple times, this has happened on Parks and Rec repeatedly. It's not fair to the residents that they can't get progress moved forward. It's hung up some pretty important projects because they could not get their decisions made at that committee level. So I appreciate the feedback we received, but again, this would only occur when it was necessary for a quorum. And then also, I'd like to make a comment about how strongly I feel about the need to interview applicants to screen for conflict of interest in the cases of commissions and boards that have tremendous standalone power, that make decisions that don't come to City Council for review. It's very important that we're able to ask questions to consider conflict of interest. We're not asking them how they would vote on a particular issue. All we're doing is making sure that there is no conflict of interest for their service on that commission, committee, board. Unfortunately, in the past, we've assumed that a thoughtful resident would recuse themselves if that were the case, but we have unfortunately found that is not the case. And so it is our due diligence to make sure if we're appointing someone to a committee or a commissioner or board that has quite a bit of power, that we need to make sure those conflict of interest don't exist. So I just like to make that comment publicly. Thank you.
Okay, so before you do an amendment, let me ask the city attorney. Mr. Krueger, would it be possible for us, as a matter of boilerplate, not in the individual sections, but at the head of the section for boards and commissions, that we stipulate that any meeting times would be established by the commission at the beginning of their operating year?
The section for boards, committees, and commissions doesn't have a general section, so we'd have to create a section that would be applicable to all of those if that's something that was desired. Otherwise, it would take, we would have to go through each individual committee and commission and fit it into the meeting section that they schedule that, but we'd need a formal motion with that language to do that this evening.
Okay, so would we need, okay, so, all right.
We certainly could take up the balance of that at a later time. If you pass the changes here, then we can bring another ordinance amendment with those specific changes that would give me the time I need to make sure I vet out all the sections, because each committee is different. They don't meet on a calendar. I mean, they meet on a calendar year, mm-hmm. but each of them pick their chairs and vice chairs at various points in the year. And so it would be much easier to address those within the next, you know, 60 days, something like that, to make sure that we address those concerns.
Mm-hmm. That'd be acceptable?
Yes, that's, okay. I think that's acceptable. Thank you.
All right. Councillor Lipke?
I have a problem with defining and saying that we have to meet between 6:30 and 8. I mean, there are no longer normal work hours. People work 24 hours a day. It depends on their schedule. Some of the committees I've been on meet at 4. It's like Sheila said, one met at 1:30. I'd rather have something, if we do put it in stone like that, and once you start doing that, you're creating problems in the future, but I'd rather have a majority of the members of each committee decide at the beginning what's the best time for them to meet. But it may be 4, maybe 4:30, it may be 1. Again, and I don't want to leave any citizens out from complaints, but they could, I think it'd be easier to accommodate the citizens than to set something in stone and knock people off committees who could contribute much to it. My other comment would deal with the, and our city manager addressed it somewhat, but the state statutes. I have no problem with the language of neglect of duty, official malfeasance, and misconduct. Inefficiency, I guess I can live with. My big concern there is I don't want to shoot ourselves in the foot by saying that we're going to allow individuals who maybe come before commissions and boards to complain about somebody. I'm afraid we may not get good people on some committees because of the fear that a citizen may not like what they hear and take something frivolous and make it into, you know, try to wind it around one of these you know, called inefficiency or whatever. I know the statute's there, I know what it says, but if somebody comes before a committee and doesn't get the ruling they want on a code violation or whatever, are they going to turn on individuals on that committee? So that's a real concern of mine.
Well, they wouldn't be able to bring it forth to directly to us, or to, you know, there would be a process.
Right. They could use one of these as a they could hook it on inefficiency, for instance.
Well, yes, but Madam City Attorney, could you explain?
There would be due process, so they wouldn't a verified complaint, and that's a sworn complaint, would have to be filed. That would then have to be heard before the Appointment Review Committee and then to the City Council. So that should vet out a lot of your frivolous claims. That won't stop them all.
Right.
The idea of allowing an individual to bring the claim is also to mimic state statute, which allows a resident taxpayer to bring a complaint against someone. So this is meant to mirror the provisions that are in state law.
State statute.
Sure. Correct.
So we're trying to follow the state laws here. So,
thank you. That's all. Okay. I wanted.
All right. All right. Did you want to make a formal amendment? Okay.
Well, I'd also like to respond. The committees and commissions and boards in question where we've set the time, I'd like to emphasize that part of their purpose is to encourage resident input, and the particular ones that we've named are ones that the residents need access to. It's not just a matter of meeting and whatever's most convenient for those members to meet, and that's then what should guide when they meet. Those are public committees, commissions, and boards that the public needs to be able to get to and share their comments and concerns. So I would be concerned if we're using that as our decision for, you know, throwing out, you know, a required meeting time for some of those commissions, committees, and boards. And I guess what I also would like to respond to allowing residents to be able to come forward and register a concern that has to follow due diligence, because the people that are sitting on that commission, committee, or board might not be aware of an issue or concern. So I think particularly in conflict of interest, they might not be aware of it, and so we need residents to have the access and ability to register that complaint and allow it to follow due process. You know, I think that's very important.
Right. Thank you. Right. Well, I tend to agree with Councilor DeForest on you know, when, you know, customer, we, I would say citizen-facing committees that are dealing with citizens' business, that they need to be set at times that are more, you know, and that's one of the reasons why we wrote it the way we've written it, is so that we could have times where the majority of citizens would be able to respond. There are a few commissions where that's not a significant issue, but many are. Mm-hmm.
which are the ones, the most pertinent ones that are the that we can easily think of are already in the ordinance. But did you want to have a motion?
Yes, I'd like to motion an amendment that the traffic review and the equal opportunity commissions are included in the stipulation that they are required to meet between the hours of 6:30 and 8 p.m. given the nature of those committees.
Is that clear?
Would there be a second to that, just before I prepare the language?
Do I have a second? Okay.
So let's vote on it.
Okay, sure. All right. So seconded by Kincaid.
Okay. So section 34 would be amended to read, regular meetings of the commission shall be held at the location designated in the notice of the meeting at, hold on.
Starting at a time no sooner than 6:30 p.m. and no later than 8 p.m.
Yes. Right. On the third Wednesday of each even-numbered month, if any regular meeting is a holiday, the commission shall establish another meeting date and time, end quote. And then the traffic review.
Meet on Mondays.
That would be section 74 to read, regular meetings of the committee shall be held at the location designated in the notice of the meeting at a starting time no sooner than 6:30, no later than 8 p.m. on the fourth Monday of each month, period, end quote. Is that correct?
That's correct. Thank you.
Okay, so having understood what the amendment is, and we've got a motion and a second, do we have any other questions or comments on this motion, on this amendment? Hearing none, I'll call the matter. Oh, do you, Councilor Slacker, go ahead.
If a resident needed to discuss something, couldn't they bring that to the commission so they could have a, you know, time to meet with them? If, for example, they don't meet in between 6:30 and 8?
Well, that hasn't worked very well in
there's
the past.
No mechanism
yeah,
for
there's
that.
There's no mechanism. Mm-hmm. They could write a letter, but they could come and address.
Because I know, like, for the EOC, there's the plan commission that meets after us. So it's a, you know, we would have to, like, move the date even, or, well, that's all I had to say.
Okay, sure. All right, then.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Just one more. I guess for me, I just want to emphasize, this is not about convenience. This is about doing what's right by these citizen-facing committees. If someone has an equal opportunities commission complaint, they should be able to access that committee irregardless of other factors. I guess to me the priority of people having access to come and speak to that committee is having to change a meeting day. So thank you. I'll just leave
thank
it
you.
At that.
Okay. All right then. Well, we
should ask a question.
Sure.
Is the intent of having hours 6:30 to 8, is that to be the inclusive, starting at 6:30, ending at 8?
No.
Okay, I want to be clear
that's
on
so that.
That
they says, will still set their own time at the beginning
okay,
of the
operating year. Okay, so we can start
year.
Anytime after 6:30 and stay as long as we want.
The intent was to be able to okay. juggle the schedules as required.
Good.
The problem with that, some people make it off work at 4, 4:30, 5 might be better. 6 to, and after is maybe children time, bedtime, dinner time, things like that. So to lock yourself in like that, I'm very much against. I'm going to vote against it.
Okay. All right. Do we have any other questions or comments? Let's call the matter on that, on the amendment. All in favor of the amendment, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Nay.
All right. The amendment fails by a vote of 4-2. All right. Do we have any other? We still have the underlying matter. Do we have any other amendments or questions or comments from councilors? Hearing none, I'll call the matter. All in favor, say aye.
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 Any opposed? Item passes by a vote of 6-0. Right. And Madam City Attorney, I think we'll, I'm sure attempting to codify and address the additional matter we can deal with at a later date.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. So, item 7D.
is an ordinance to amend various sections of 14.22 of the Code of General Ordinances for the City of Beloit pertaining to Sidewalk Cafe. This is first reading.
Madam Director.
We currently have a Sidewalk Cafe ordinance, which allows a Sidewalk Cafe to be located on sidewalks in the Business Permit District, which is generally the downtown. But they have to obtain an annual Sidewalk Cafe license. The current ordinance requires a removal of all Sidewalk Cafe furniture, furnishings, and equipment from the public sidewalk between the hours of 1 a.m. And it should actually say 5 a.m., not 5 p.m. In the staff report. I'm sorry for that. We did receive a court request from a downtown business who would like to allow a bench to be permanently located on the sidewalk, which would not be allowed under the current code. So we are modifying it to allow to say that they may remain on the sidewalk between 1 a.m. and 5 a.m. However, it would require the items to be secured. This would ensure that the items would not be picked up and removed while the business is closed, or picked up by the wind, or picked up and thrown into a nearby window. The additional amendments are, the current ordinance says that the DBA Executive Board reviews these. They have separate committees that they would like to review them instead. Section 3 removes an incorrect code reference to the zoning ordinance. Section 4 removes a section of code, which we don't think is necessary because there's two that are kind of the same. And then Section 5 removes a requirement that people may only have an alcoholic beverage served to them in an outdoor seating area in conjunction with a meal. We don't think that that condition is necessary. We are asking that you suspend the rules and approve this evening. The downtown business owner has been waiting for quite some time to get this permanent bench, and we just didn't have the time to get this ordinance put together. So now that we have it, we'd ask that you just take action tonight.
All right, thank you.
If I could just make clarification.
Yes, please go right ahead.
I want to be clear that it cannot be a permanent structure affixed to the sidewalk at all. It just merely limits takes away the requirement that they be brought in each night. So there won't be anything affixed to any public property.
Sure. They'll have to find some other way to secure it in such
Correct.
A fashion it can't be carried off. All right. All right. Do we have a
motion to approve.
Motion to suspend the rules first.
Suspend.
Moved by Lubke.
Second
by Kelly. Madam Vice President.
Thank you. I guess this might be related to whether I'll vote to suspend the rules. If it can't be attached to the concrete sidewalk, I'm trying to figure out how they'll secure it without using some crazy bulky chains or sand contraptions. And
there are anchoring devices that are available.
Okay.
There are, I jokingly called it an anchor, but it is an anchoring device that can be used. Mm-hmm. And I think it's clear that the design review committee from the DBA and planning staff would have to approve the device that is used to secure. So what we're trying to do is prevent any damage to the sidewalk, public property, but at the same time, make sure that there aren't dangers that could be prevented by securing them.
Okay, thank you.
Right. Do we have any other questions or comments before suspending the rules or voting to suspend the rules? All right. I'll call the matter. All in favor of suspending the rules, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? We've suspended the rules by a vote of 6-0. Moved by Lubke. Second by Sloniker. Any other questions or comments? Hearing none, I'll call the matter. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Item passes by a vote of 6-0. Item 8 are appointments. The individuals named below have been nominated for a seat on the board, commission, or committee. Each nomination is subject to the confirmation by the City Council. Approval of the appointments will be accomplished by one motion unless a council member requests to take a nomination separately, in which event the nomination will be removed from the general order of business and considered at this point of the agenda. We have appointments for... Gratifyingly for most commissions.
And you need to acknowledge that, Anna.
And since Councillor Kelly is leaving the council, and she's has been forwarded for appointment, she has recused herself.
For that one, right?
What's that one? Excuse me.
Just for item I.
Just for item I. But she's gone ahead, and I think she's gone ahead and recused herself overall. So because we haven't pulled her item from the agenda, so. All right, do you have any persons wishing to come forward and speak or pull any counselors wishing to pull someone from the agenda? Councilor DeForest.
I don't know if we're actually pulling this from the agenda, but I would like the Police and Fire Commission items. I'd like to comment on those. And
You certainly can. Should we go ahead and just, we'll handle that just the way we would handle it on consent. Okay. If you wish to pull it.
Yes, I'll pull it then. Thank you. Item I.
Do we have any other councilors wishing to pull anything else from the appointment?
I ask a question about all of the items. We talked about ethics. Have these appointments been vetted for ethics for the various commissions and committees?
I think that's an evolving process, but
that'll be a no.
Conflicts of interest are dependent upon very certain set of facts, and so something can come before a committee that someone may have a conflict on and others not. I mean, I wasn't part of the appointment review process, so I don't know if that issue was addressed directly. But if you have a committee member that is facing something on an agenda, we would certainly hope that they would recuse themselves if they do find themselves in conflict, and then any referrals of a conflict would be sent to the Ethics Committee or Ethics Board.
Well, I guess related to that, if I may, is it too late to request that Board of Ethics DB pulled as well?
Well, I think
protocol.
Well, I think at this point, my thought process is that the ordinance just passed means that we have the basic quorum of five members that are the chairs of the five major committees, and this would just be one of the persons of, and I believe we all understand the basics here. So at this point, first, do we have a motion to approve the appointments 8A through 8H? Moved by Lupke, second by Sloniker. Do we have any other questions or comments on that body of appointments? Hearing none, I'll call the matter. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? We've appointed the following members. Jerome Jennings, Dan Gifford, J. Zick, Judy Robson, John S. Emery, Tressie Webster, William K. Mays, Ida Lentz, Angela P. Moore, Matthew Finnegan, and Timothy Whedon to their posts, as shown in the agenda. Item 8I.
That's a Police and Fire Commission appointment for Tressie Brown, replacing Craig Zastro, and Anna Kelly, replacing Timmy Link.
Right. Do we have a motion to approve these?
Motion approved.
Moved by Lupke.
Second.
Second by Sloniker. And you had a question for us?
Yes, thank you. A question and a comment. I guess more a comment. I would prefer that the individuals in question receive a city council interview. I know that we hadn't quite passed the ordinance where we require that the city council interview for commissions, committees, and boards that have standalone authority and power. So I understand that this is, ahead of when we pass that, but I'd like to request that this item be laid over so that we can indeed interview the two individuals for the Police and Fire Commission. I'm sorry I was remiss in not recognizing that I should have done the same for other cases where we had a commission, committee, or board that had standalone authority, but at least for the Police and Fire Commission, I would like to request that we lay that item over.
Is your motion to lay over?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Do we have a second for that motion? Okay, moved and seconded. All in favor of laying over, say aye.
Aye.
That was three. So we have four layover. That would be Councillor Sloniker, Councillor Kincaid, and Councillor DeForest. All opposed, say aye or nay?
Nay.
Nay. Okay, so we've laid this over by a vote of 3-2.
Thank you.
That would be to the next meeting. All right, then. Where is Councilor Kelly? Just to recap, the appointment for the Police and Fire Commission was laid over pending the interview process. Okay. All right. So item 9 would be councilor activities and upcoming events. And I'll start with Councilor Slonaker.
Yes, I attended a lot of meetings, just general stuff, extra special meetings, and I'm looking really forward to some of the things that are upcoming, like Arbor Day for the YWCA, and then, oh, I forgot the other one, but anyways, some really neat events are coming up that I look forward to attending. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Kelly.
I have not much to report. Well, I have a lot, but I just want to say thank you to everybody. I don't want to miss sitting with you guys. It's been a very nice experience the last 2 years working through this. So it's been a pleasure to serve. And I'm sure I'll be seeing everybody.
Thank you. Councilor Lipke.
I don't want to focus on anything that I've done in the last couple weeks. I'd rather talk about something more important, and that is thanking Anna, yourself, Charles, and Chuck for the service the last couple years, and then for the last 8 years for you, Charles. We've worked as a team. We've worked very hard at times. We're going to miss you. And as Bob Hope said often, thanks for the memories.
Thank you.
That's all I have.
Thank you. And since we're lopsided today, I'll go ahead and hit Councillor Kincaid next.
I attended a very important meeting with someone I know very well. Last Saturday, we went to Madison, attended the Women's Summit. There are several people from Beloit there. Donna Shalala, the former provost of the university, was there and spoke, gave a wonderful a speech about really women's issues. And there were a few of us men who could hear him about him and learn, happily. Another panel was held having to do with human trafficking in Wisconsin and the programs that are addressing that problem. So. It was a good weekend for information, and I'll certainly miss all the meetings we go to and have to report with the Planning Commission and so forth. So.
Right. Thank you. And Madam Vice President.
Thank you. I would like to report on the activities that attended recently and also make my remarks about the outgoing city councilors, partly because I think it's really important that we acknowledge Beloit's own, who were recognized at the YWCA's Women of Distinction Awards. Regina Hendricks, Michelle Hendricks-Nora, and Lynn Jones, Beloit's own, were recognized at that event, and I think it's important that we also acknowledge and celebrate them. And I think it's important that we congratulate Jeff and Judy Adams, who received an award from the Friends Riverfront at the Rise and Shine event for their behind-the-scenes work that they have done to really beautify a riverfront and to improve Beloit. Excited about YMCA's groundbreaking. It was cold, but it was wonderful to attend. I've got my little ducky here. And I really want to acknowledge the library staff and volunteers. They had an ice cream social activity that our city manager was able to present at, and there were quite a few library patrons there. The library means a lot to them, and I want to let you know how much we appreciate all you do to really make sure the library services are accessible, and enjoyed the Courthawks barbershop music. That was such a nice treat. I had no idea they were going to be there. That was wonderful. And want to acknowledge Caritas Food Pantry. Donna Ambrose and her volunteers had an open house to show us the changes they've made to the food pantry, improvements to try to make sure that no one in our community goes hungry. So I just feel like I have to make sure I acknowledge those important people in Beloit who are doing great things. And I want to deeply express my gratitude to our outgoing counselors.
I'll start with Charles. We've served together. We came in together 8 years ago, and we haven't always agreed on everything, but my respect for him has never changed. We always leave council as friends, and that's very important. An example that we can share our community, that we can have very strong disagreement, have very different perspectives on issues, and still have respect for each other and leave as friends. And you know, this has been especially a difficult year, and he has led us honorably in this past year, and I deeply appreciate what he's done, because I know firsthand how grueling it's been, the emails, the phone calls, the relentless complaints that we receive. We hear from people all the time when they think things aren't going well. We rarely hear from people when they think that we've done a good job. So that's difficult to bear the brunt of. We, for the most part, do this as volunteers. And most of us work full time and have families, loved ones that we're also trying to balance and support. So I want to express my appreciation to you and to Gudrun, who's here, for supporting him. For Anna Kelly, you've taught me a lot. I really appreciate, I didn't understand historic preservation and its role and importance as deeply as I do now. So thank you for your patience with me. I'm still, you know, I got some issues still, as you know, but I have a deeper appreciation for it, and I want to thank you and your significant other, Rick, for really serving the city well and supporting everything that goes on well. What you do at BIF alone behind the scenes, that people have no idea the countless hours that you spend. So I just want to acknowledge and appreciate you. And then finally, Chuck Kincaid, thank you for asking some great questions. I really appreciated times when you have raised questions and issues that I had not thought of. You've been such a valuable asset here, the experience that you've brought. And thank you to your significant other, Sandy, for all that you've done. You got here in Beloit and you jumped right in and have served with the library and served our council and all the great activities that you've done. So I want to make sure that you know how deeply we respect and appreciate you. And we know we'll see you around, but we just want to publicly be able to say that. So thank you.
Thank you, Sheila. Well, my whole thought as we went into this was that I wouldn't acknowledge any of this, that we would just, this would be the last meeting and no one would see me the next time, and nobody would know what on earth happened. My preference for doing those things, when I left the Army, they handed me my D-214 and a plane ticket and said bye. And I figured that's the way it would be here. But obviously that's all blown out of the water right now. So in the last 8 years, I've worked with some of the greatest, most professional people that it has ever been my pleasure to work with. City staff, city managers, planning people, you know, persons in City Hall and in every city function. The counselors that have sat beside me have been top flight the whole way. People who earnestly desire what's best for the city and are prepared to sacrifice for it. And people who've just simply volunteered to be with us all the time. Tony, Coach, we're every meeting, always there to with us. My friend Marty came to my last meeting he and I sat together for a number of years. It's been an amazing journey. I can always say that it's, from my perspective, it was always about duty. It was always about sacrifice. And I never really asked for anything out of it other than to make sure that my community was a better place at the end of it. Mm-hmm. So thank you very much for joining me on that walk. And I appreciate you, Sheila. And again, we came on together and we've had a lot of, we've worn the rough spots off of our gears. So. the people here are my friends, and I appreciate you very, very much, more than I can say. All right, I'll leave that as, and we'll move on to item 10. Councillor Slonaker. Go ahead.
I didn't get a chance. I was a newcomer, so I didn't get the chance to know you as well as the other councillors, but I just want to say thank you, and I appreciate what you've done for our community. And
thank you.
Wish you well.
All right.
Thank you.
All right. Item 10 is City Manager's presentation to item 10A.
It's a presentation and resolution amending the 2016 capital improvement budget.
Before the presentation, I just wanted to preface that this is a cost-neutral proposal. We have looked at existing CIP projects that were really developed late last year and made some proposed revisions and repurposing of those dollars to be able to provide adequate funding for the programs and services that you're about to hear about. I think we have a fair amount of detail, and it's a really exciting new way to advance the operations of the police department and to do it in a cost-neutral way. So I'll turn it over to Chief Sobalski for his presentation, and then if there are any questions, we'll both be happy to respond to those.
Chief.
Thank you. Good. Next one. Go right there. Thanks. Okay, so as the city manager said, we've reviewed our future needs, our current resources, and our budgetary expenditures, and the request to reallocate one of our CIPs that had previously been passed. And it involves the $125,000, $50,000 for a prisoner van, and $75,000 for tasers, the conducted electronic weapons that the cops carry. And in looking at that, our tasers will need replacement in the in 2017. However, our complete audio-video IT platform is kind of a hodgepodge. The MVARS, mobile video audio system that's in the squads, we've been trying to nip and tuck it and get it through because it's to the point where it either has to be replaced with the current vendor, who we are not very happy with. The technology of that particular system is not good. It breaks often. We have to expend a lot of time and money in terms of autos, cars running, gas-wise, to upload video. The system just creates terabytes of data that has kind of adversely affected our IT resources. Along with that, we have 10 body cameras that are sitting on the shelf since 2014 that we have not been able to put into action. But we would like to move to body cameras later this year. In our interrogation rooms, our interview rooms, there's three of those in the department, are really nothing more than a Home Depot version of audio and video. And I've watched these. They are not very good. They are not criminal justice types of systems. And they're a completely different network. And they also create their own terabytes of data. And then every time there's a court case, discovery, etc., we have personnel who have to copy these audio and video files on the discs for the DA. So there's an amount of personnel time that is spent on those same types of things. So in order to really bring us into the next, I guess, modern era of policing, I would call it, we would like to get a consistent IT platform that addresses all of these issues. So in terms of the interrogation rooms, that was excellent timing. Thank you. The interrogation rooms would be completely outfitted with new audio and video, and all of our storage would go on the cloud. So evidence.com storage, which is in effect in many police departments across the country and in Wisconsin, is a cloud-based storage system. We have there is no limit on cloud storage. So all of our interrogations, recordings, would go right into that on cloud system. The other thing that does is it allows the district attorney and the city attorney to have a link to this system. We don't have to make copies of audio and video anymore and spend any personnel time. The DAs and city attorneys can look and pull out the audio video that they need and then make whatever copies they feel they need for court, or they can just review the interrogation or the incident before they make a charging decision. The in-cars videos, same thing here. We have two cameras now. That's kind of a pretty car, right?
Yeah.
We don't have squads like that.
Yeah, $90,000 Tesla. I hope not.
Yeah. No, we don't have that. We'll have the same two cameras, front and back with audio. This will be a much more robust system in terms, again, it will upload to the cloud. There are Wi-Fi capabilities that Taser Axon is developing that we will benefit from, and that will give us the ability at some point in the near future to upload our video from anywhere in the street through a Wi-Fi connection versus having to come to the station, park, and run the vehicle until the video uploads, if it uploads,
So that will, again, create a lot of efficiencies. No matter where they are, they'll get that stuff uploaded, and we won't be waiting for cars while video is uploading, or we won't lose video. In terms of the body-worn cameras, you know, there's a lot of benefits to those. That's 2015 San Diego PD data on complaints and use of force decreases as a result of body cameras, and the Mesa PD data is from 2013. I believe that would greatly help those issues with our department, as well as create a lot more transparency and trust in the community. 95% of major cities have gone with this particular product. In terms of body cameras, our current platform with this package, they would download and dox at the end of a shift. Every cop would have a body camera, so there isn't an issue there. However, they will have Wi-Fi capabilities in the future as well. So not only will we be able to upload in-car video, we'll be able to upload body cam video from the street with this particular package. Real future, again, as we kind of grow and continue to make the department more flexible, we'll have the ability for apps, videos, auto recordings via our iPhones as well. So this platform and this package not only is cost-effective and a better use of our budgetary monies, but it affords us, puts us in a position where we can continue to grow and adapt and continue on to stay in front of the IT curve instead of behind the IT curve. Again, just an example of how it goes basically from the street to court. Okay, all the attorneys, citizens, in terms of our open records, it's going to be easier for us to address those issues. And there's always the issue of the FBI Criminal Justice Information Systems oversees all criminal justice data. So you have to have physical and logical separation of that criminal justice data to be in compliance with the FBI. If you're not, they'll take that ability away from your law enforcement agency. This cloud storage is CJIS compliant. Years previously it may not have been, but they have now stepped up their ability to make it CJIS compliant, so there's really no reason not to utilize the cloud and eliminate the terabytes of data we've got stockpiled in our IT area. You go to the next one. Yeah. Okay. 5,000 agencies. And then in terms of our rollout plan, just to give you a little idea of how we would do this, the interrogation rooms would get done right away. And the evidence cloud storage would come with that right away as well. So that part of it would be in play as soon as they could get it going. We would then move to our in-car video and start replacing those. Tasers would be replaced. And with this package, the tasers are replaced every 5 years. So we no longer have to repurchase tasers. Well, there's a maintenance portion to this that allows for replacement and upgrade. The body cameras are replaced and upgraded every 2.5 years. So at a 2.5 phase and at 5 years, body cameras will be upgraded and replaced. And when the Wi-Fi connectivity becomes available, we'll get that opportunity as well. We place body cameras at the bottom of the rollout to give us an opportunity to review, discuss policy, have discussions with the council and citizens so that everyone understands the pros and cons of body cam video, because there are many aspects to it that a lot of people don't understand. So that will give us a chance to roll that out and have those discussions, and in fall in service we would be able to implement the tasers and the body cams would be our hope on that timeline.
There was one other item that I thought of while you were talking. Really want to publicly thank our city attorney and the chief. Over the course of the past year, they took a recommendation, and I may get the name of the committee incorrect, but the Public Records Board really mandates or regulates how we have retention policies and what that applies to. And through their efforts and really hours and hours from the city attorney, we were able to get our records retention exception for video and records that are not needed for evidentiary purposes. And that is a huge aspect to this. And understanding what our retention policy is, having the storage capacity in order to handle it, all of those items are really critical. And so thank you very much for that work. I just can't overemphasize how incredibly important to our entire organization having that successfully accomplished has been for us.
All right. Thank you. Do we have a motion to approve the amendment to the capital budget?
So moved.
Okay. Moved by DeForest, second by Lubke, and Councillor DeForest.
Thank you. I am thrilled. I've been assertively asking for body cameras for the last 2 years and was told that it could not be done. I just want to make sure, just for the general public, because I certainly had this question immediately, how secure is the cloud in terms of this information being there? And then finally, when you're saying it's CJIS compliant, I'm assuming that there are guidelines in there that are meant to protect minors from being captured, and when those are shared, because you said these are times for open records requests that they could be shared, and we have a mechanism for protecting minors and their identity in this.
Right. Well, that would be part of the open policy itself.
Okay.
And then the open records request, we would just follow current law to redact what we need to redact. In terms of the security, it's more secure than anything we have. The FBI CJIS manual is about this thick.
Okay.
And every once in a while, they put out a change that's this thick. And so it requires fingerprint background checks for personnel that have any connectivity
access.
Or access to this information, right? So it's pretty stringent. And they have met that requirement with this cloud storage. So from that perspective, we have total confidence in that.
Wonderful. And then one concern I'd like to raise, and you're probably way ahead of me, and I'm sure we'll discuss this in terms of how uses of body cameras might hinder informants from sharing information.
But, and that's just a policy issue.
Okay.
I mean, when we discuss policy, and there's a number of best practice policies out there already. IACP has one, and it's really... it won't be that difficult just working from the best practice policy and determining if there's any things that we want to augment from our from our position in terms of that, or
okay.
Video in private residences, etc. So there's pros, cons, and mm-hmm. we'll just work through mm-hmm. that.
So part of that policy, I'm assuming, will be some expectations that our officers are trained on about when to have the body camera on and when not to.
Right.
So for example, I know with our cars that when the sirens and lights are activated, it trips those cameras. So we'll have a mechanism like that that's clear to officers when to keep it on and when to turn it off.
Right. And, okay. and again, in policy development, a lot of departments... because it's very difficult to be black and white on that.
Yes,
because
I
so
understand.
Many things are dynamic and the cops don't really know what they're walking into. So, but again, there's best practice policy dealing with all of those issues. And that's why we wanted to do it in the fall. So when we get to an in-service, we hit all the cops, we give them that training, and this training actually comes with the purchase for the body cams. And we'll have that opportunity. And there's a number of departments in Wisconsin that have them in use now that we've talked to. And so we have peers that we can go to and ask questions as we look at policy and protocols.
Great. Thank you.
Do we have any other questions or comments before I call the matter?
Anna, yes.
Councillor Kelly.
So about cloud storage.
Yes.
You said there's no cost for cloud storage, or is there a fixed cost for cloud
storage?
No,
there is cost for the cloud storage. The cost is in the package. There is, yeah.
So it's like does the cost change with, as the storage increases, I'm assuming, or is it fixed at all?
No, it's the only increase would be if there's a business increase in the cost of that particular storage. So this gets us through 5 years, essentially, and then after that, whatever the cost of that storage is would be a budgetary issue for us to address, and would have several years to
I can see that
review and do
every
that.
Year. I mean,
right.
They're storing things for a long time.
Right, and with the retention schedule that we now have, we're able to, well, it's easier with this system to tab evidence or to tab it as training or to tab it at a particular 90 or 180-day retention and then remove it from the cloud.
Sorry, guys.
Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay.
Councilor DeForest.
Thank you. I have another question related to that. You had mentioned with the tasers that we're paying a maintenance fee so that we would just get those replaced on a regular cycle.
Mm-hmm.
So are we locked in the same way with the body cameras? So if, let's say, their charges start escalating, are we able to walk away, or are we kind of locked in as well?
Right. Well, in terms of the replacement?
Yes.
After 5 years?
Storage issues, yeah.
Well, the cloud storage would be, yes, if there's an increase in the cost of that, just like any equipment. But the body cameras were good for 5 years. I mean, this package purchases everything we need, and it includes a replacement at 2.5 and at 5 years.
Okay.
So as we would move into the next cycle, we would be doing that with new equipment. And then we could determine from there, you know, if we want to continue with this company, you know, in 5 years, who knows? But
okay.
I think 5 years is a good plan to put something like this together. We have everything going in the same direction.
Great. Thank you.
Right. Do you have any other questions or comments? Hearing none, I'll call the matter. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Item passes by a vote of 6-0. Item 11, reports from boards and city officers, 11A.
Item 11A is a resolution awarding the sale of $1.75 million in general obligation promissory notes, Series 2016A.
Good evening.
Mr. Miller.
Each year, the City of Beloit issues general obligation notes and general obligation bonds in order to fund its capital program. 4 weeks ago, you guys signed the initial resolutions, which allowed us to go out and get bids for those notes and bonds. And so with us tonight, I have Dawn Gunderson from Ellers & Associates, who will now go through the bid document and the sale documents that you guys will be considering tonight.
Dawn.
Thank you. Good evening. Before the meeting, we distributed a document that included amended resolutions from what was prepared for your preliminary packet. This afternoon, your bond attorney, Quarles and Brady, updated those resolutions with the actual results of your sale this morning. So that action that you will take this evening will be those resolutions that were distributed. As Eric mentioned, at your meeting last month in April, you authorized resolutions for us to proceed with competitive sales for your financing of your 2016 capital budget. Following that meeting, we prepared a preliminary official statement, which was distributed and mailed to all of you. We held a rating conference call with Standard & Poor's, at which time they have assigned an A-plus rating to the City of Beloit. That rating equates to interest rates, much like a credit score does on a personal for a personal loan. So that rating certainly helps you when it comes to marketing your debt. This morning at 11 o'clock, we took bids on both your promissory notes and your general obligation bonds. And the two documents that were also included in your packet are entitled sale day reports. I will walk through the sale day report for the promissory note issue first and then proceed to the bond issue. There's action would be done on each of those items. On the sale day report for the promissory notes 2016A, the resolution you're considering this evening will be for $1,725,000 general obligation promissory notes. That is a reduction from the original sizing that we went to market of $25,000. We're pleased to report that we did receive four bids during our competitive sale process. And the winning bid is determined by the true interest cost. So in the document that I distributed on page one, we summarized the comparison between the high and the low bid. The low bid was with Bosk Inc., which is a subsidiary of Bank of Oklahoma. Their bid was 1.5191 TIC. That's the low bid. Our high bid was 1.7984. These are for 10-year notes, so that's the true interest cost for those notes. That's a difference of $32,000, so we find benefit in doing it competitively because it allows you to select that low bid. There's a schedule on this document that kind of summarizes a few of the high points from the issue, but I'll walk you through the next couple of schedules. Beginning on page two is a recap, a bid tabulation of the four bids that we did receive. Again, the low bid is the winning bid, and it's identified by the far right column, the TIC. You can see the TIC then for each of the bids on the next two pages, pages two and pages three, with the four bidding underwriters. And then if you turn to page four, this is a comparison of our preliminary planning sizing and our final sale results. It's the determination that allowed us to reduce the issue size. There's a few things that are estimated at the time we go to market, some of the issuance expenses. When an underwriter bids, they bid on your interest rate and they bid on their discount, which is the fee that you pay for them to place the debt. Those with the bidding process there, the underwriter's discount came in lower than our bid. We also had a premium bid that helps us offset that. That premium then is also deposited in your debt service reserve fund to pay for, or debt service fund to help pay for interest expense. So the difference with those two components allowed us to reduce the bond size by $25,000. If you'll turn to the next large pullout page, I'll just kind of focus on the note issue in this. This is the schedule we had reviewed when we set the sale, has all your existing debt and the impact of that debt on your levy, and the incorporation of this issue as well as the bonds and your future capital planning. But my attention will be in this column entitled the GO promissory notes. And the bottom, there's a boxed area that gives you kind of the comparison between our final sale and our planning. So here you'll see that the issue size was reduced by $25,000 in principal. Also with the bids that we received on the sale, our interest expense is $59,000 lower. We have $32,000 that will go into your debt service fund to help pay for the first year's interest expense. So ultimately, with the results of today's sale on the promissory notes, it's $116,000 of less impact in terms of cost to finance your capital projects and your capital equipment under your note issue between the principal and the interest and the additional premium on the issue. So that's kind of summarizes the note issue. Both of these documents include a copy of your rating report from S&P. I encourage you to read that. It talks a little bit about the types of things that could help you increase your bond rating and also the things that could negatively affect that as well. If you'd like, I can proceed with the discussion on the bonds, or if you want to go ahead and take note. Okay. The second document is, again, the corporate purpose bonds. This is financing the larger, longer-term improvements, many of your street improvements, and major capital items. This pre-sale report, again, there's a resolution attached to this as well. The resolution you'll be considered this evening will be for $3,235,000 of GO corporate purpose bonds. Your initial resolution was $45,000 larger. We were able to reduce the size of this as well. Pleased to report, we also had four bids on this issue. Our low bid for the TIC was with Piper Jaffray out of Minneapolis at a TIC of 2.3996% was our low bid. Our high bid was 2.5977. The difference between the high and the low on this was $79,500 of interest expense. So again, benefit of taking the low bid on this action as well. On page two of this document is the bid tabulation. This is identified again in order of the winning bid, Piper Jaffray, with the TIC identified to the far right. There are term bonds in this, so there would be mandatory redemptions and a paying agent associated with this issue. And then on pages three and four are the other bids, again, in the order of low bid to high bid on the other underwriters bidding on this issue. On page five of this document, again, is a comparison between the preliminary planning, sizing, and the final. Again, here, our underwriter discount bid item came in lower than our planning estimates. And in addition to that, we had a reoffering premium, which absorbed that cost and allowed for some deposit into debt service. So because of that, we were able to reduce this issue by $45,000, directly related to that underwriter discount. So your authorization is for the $3,235,000. The page six, again, is that pullout schedule. This time we'll focus on the middle columns, which are related to the bond issue. And to the bottom of that schedule, this is the principal and interest structuring for the issue. We were able to reduce the principal by $45,000. Due to the positive results on the sale, our interest is $335,000 lower than our planning estimates. We have $52,000 that will go into the debt service reserve. So the total cost from your preliminary planning at the point you allowed us to proceed with this to today's sale result is an overall reduction of $433,000 less in cost. So we're pleased to report that those positive results are coming in at a lower cost to the city to accomplish its capital projects. Again, the rating report is attached, as well as the final document is kind of a snapshot of the last 12 months of interest on a 20-year maturity. It's tracked by the municipal bond indices. So the benefit at this point is we're at the low point in the 12 months in terms of interest rate, which certainly was recognized in the results of today's sale. So I'm happy to answer any questions that any of you may have on either one of those issues.
Right. Do we have a motion to approve the item 11A?
Motion to approve.
Do we have any additional questions or comments of bond assistance? All right. All right. We'll be voting for this under a roll call vote.
Councillor Kelly.
Yay.
DeForest.
Aye.
Haynes.
Aye.
Kincaid.
Aye.
Lubke.
Aye.
Sloniker.
Aye.
That passes unanimously.
All right. Item 11B.
Make the motion for approval.
Moved by Lubke.
Second
by Kelly. And this one will also be a roll call vote.
Councillor Kelly?
Aye.
DeForest?
Aye.
Haynes?
Aye.
Kincaid?
Aye.
Lubke?
Aye.
Sloniker? That passes unanimously.
All right. Thank you, Don. All right. It's item 11C is next.
Is a resolution authorizing the schedule of fees and charges for stormwater management.
Mr. Boyson.
The city is updating the stormwater and erosion control ordinance, as council did earlier this evening, to be consistent with how the city handles fees within ordinances. This resolution has been developed with the standard form of stormwater fee schedules. As the city manager reported earlier, there's really no change in the fees. It's primarily just changing the format to match our current format. And it's recommended to approve the resolution as presented for the fee schedule.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Boyson. Do we have a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Lubke, second by Sloniker. Any questions or comments? Hearing none, I'll just go ahead and make my own to reiterate. This isn't a change in the dollars that in our fees. It just cleans up where they, you know, how we're presenting them. So that'll be should be, if I understand this correctly, revenue neutral.
Correct.
Okay. All right then. That's all I had to say. If we have no other questions or comments, I'll call the matter. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Item passes by a vote of 6-0. Item 11D.
Is a resolution approving compensation adjustments for the city manager for the calendar year 2016.
All right. One of the things present city manager, we told her that this sitting council would give her a first review. We synced it up with the rest of staff who received their reviews in March and April. We began this process at the beginning of March, and so set the review period from her hire to March 1, and that'll sync her up for the following year. At this point, given how thoroughly we dumped her off of the deep end of the pool, we believe that with weights on her feet, by the way, I've never seen a person swim so well with so much weight on her.
Yes, here.
In any case, so we did find that her ratings from us ranged from exceeds to exceptional. I fully concur, and. Right now, we have a 1% annual compensation that's typical for staff, with up to a 1% for merit. I think she fully deserves that 2%, and we're allowing for $5,000 in additional relocation expenses because of the long time it took for her to sell her house. So that's something that's all worked in. Do we have a motion to approve this compensation change for the city manager?
I'll second.
Okay. Moved by Lupke, and if you'll allow Councillor Kincaid to make the second. All right, then. If there are any other questions or comments, I'll call the matter. Say, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Item passes by a vote of 6-0.
Mr. President, before we adjourn, may I just mention one thing?
Yes, you may.
I did want to mention, after 23 years of service, Municipal Court Judge Henderson is retiring at the end of this month. We are having a small celebration on Friday the 29th between 1 and 3 p.m. I just wanted to let the public know that we do appreciate the many decades of service he has provided the city of Beloit.
Yeah, and it's, in my opinion, with Judge Henderson, it's not just his service as municipal court judge. How often he's assisted councils with alcohol hearings, and he's assisted the police and fire commission. He's assisted in any number of he's just simply been a tremendous resource for our community. I'm not certain I will be able to attend, but I certainly hope it is well attended. Do we have a motion? As my final act as council president, I'll ask for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Moved by Sloniker.
If I never second, will you just stay?
I'm afraid I don't have that option.
I'll second then.
Okay. Motion then seconded. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. We are adjourned.